I stand before you, amen, to introduce our speaker on today. Amen. Many of you know this brother. Amen. I had him write out a little bio for me, but one of the things that he that stuck out, amen, I'm going to share a few of it, but he said he's an active member of Kansas City Community Church, and he counts his church as his family. Amen. That just kind of jumped off the paper. Amen. But on today, I stand before you. Amen. On last year, we had a wonderful speaker. Amen. And God truly blessed. And I'm the type of person, amen, really didn't know. But sometimes they say you need to find out what's in the house. Amen. Amen. Before you go to somebody else's house and boil sugar and, you know, all that kind of stuff, you need to look in your cabinets and make sure that you don't already have it in your house. Amen. And so God has blessed us with so many different people, different walks of life. They've experienced a lot of different things in their lives, professional, in their job application. But as I was talking to this brother, amen, he began to share some of his hobbies, some of the things that he was very involved in. And then I spoke to other few members, and on last year, they said, you could have had this brother talk Black history, because just a wealth of knowledge and some different things that he'd done. So when I seen him on last year, I said, I'm going to have you speak and just share some of the information that God has blessed you with. And that's none other than Brother Bernard Love. Amen. Amen. Just to share just a little bit of what he gave me. He's married to, has been married to Sister Nadine Love for 37 years. Amen. Where Sister Love is right now. Yeah, Sister Love. Amen. Everybody that sees your face on Facebook with those pictures, sometimes you don't know that they being taken. Sister Love, she's the one that's taking care of that. Amen. She's a wonderful a woman of God. They have a total of 5 children. Amen. 11 grandchildren. 1 great-great-grandchild. Amen. Brother Love is, I know this about him, he's a hard worker. He works for Delta Airline, and I'm not going to tell everything he does, but I always talk to him, and I am totally convinced it's not a lot of young men that could do what he does. He's doing some heavy work there on the airlines. Amen. He's not flying the plane, but he's making sure that the plane is doing what it needs to do. Amen. Hard worker. I know he's possibly looking forward to retirement pretty soon. And we're going to pray for that. But he was born in Barstow, Florida. Served in the U.S. Army. But where he comes in with what he's going to share with on today, he owns a small business. Business is Cultural Expressions with an emphasis on African-American culture and history. He makes custom frames, and in these frames he has beautiful black art. I've seen some of his art, and it's by far exquisite. Amen. It's very beautiful. It's very meaningful. And so in order for him to display his art, amen, he must know the background and how to share the information. And so on today, amen, I've already seen a little bit of what he has, and you're going to be blessed. But after the praise and worship team blesses us with another selection, you will be in the hands, amen. I call him Dr. Love, amen. Is that all right? I know, you know, I call him Dr. Love. I'll be messing with him, amen. But Brother Love, Brother Bernard, he's going to come, and he's going to share, amen.
Good morning, church. How great is our God? And starting this morning, I would like to open with a prayer. And I would like to say, when you hear this song that we're going to play, don't look at it as secular, but pay more attention to the words. The prayer, Heavenly Father, came out in the early 70s by the OJs, which I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with. But we're going to play that song now so that you can see the impact of what the words are. So we're going to have Sister Robin go ahead and play that.
Understanding.
Thank you. When I heard that song, it really touched me, because that's who we pray to. We pray to our Heavenly Father. And we can talk about Black history and give speeches and talk about all the accomplishments, but it all goes back to Him. So I would just like to say, Heavenly Father, we honor You. We give You the praise and the glory for all of our struggles, because it is because of You that we are here today. And we thank You for all that You've done, and we thank You for Your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for the forgiveness of our sins, that we might be here to honor You. I'm going to ask, before I play this next song, that You allow me to give recognition to my wife of 37 years. You know, we are all family, but there's always somebody that, you know, is our why. And she's my why. Why I get up, why I go, why I do. But I also have my in-laws, my mother-in-law, my sister-in-law, my children. They are also my why. Because it is because of them that I can stand here this morning and do this presentation. And I thank them, and I thank God for them. I'm going to ask Robin to play the Black National Anthem again, Lift Every Voice and Sing, because we can sing that, but when you look at the words, and this particular rendition is going to show some pictures of the struggle, but it also will tell you about the glory of God to bring us this far. See, the greatest book in history starts right here. If you want to know about history, you got to study the Bible. And the Bible will teach you history. So I'm going to ask Sister Robin to play that song again for us.
Thank you.
Amen. Amen. I'm going to ask now that my son, who is here today, and my grandson, who's here today, and we're going to give the allegiance to the African American flag. I'm going to read it, and I would just like for you to listen to the words. I also have my granddaughter here. This is my son Desmond, which you all are familiar with, or you know. This is my granddaughter Lily, Aaliyah, and this is my grandson Caden. When you look at this flag, you see the red, the black, and the green. What this flag represents is the blood that our people shed for this land, the sacrifices that were made. And it says, "This flag is mine. Here to this flag of mine, the red, black, and green, hopes in the future bright Africa has seen. Here's to the red of it, great nations shall know of it in times to come. Red blood shall flow of it, great flag of mine. Here's to the black of it, for 100 millions back of it, whose destiny depended on it, the red, black, and green of it, O flag of mine. Here's to the green of it, young men shall dream of it, face shot and shell of it, maidens shall sing of it, wavering so high. Here's to the whole of it, colors brought and pole of it, please in my soul with it, regardless of what is told of it, thank God for giving me great flag of mine." Now we should, you know, we pledge allegiance to a lot of things, but this is about us pledging allegiance to ourselves. And when I think about the song that was just played, they done took this out the schools. And that's just like taking God out the school. And the only one that can do anything about it is us. We are the only ones that can do anything about it. When I got the message from the pastor about speaking on Black History Month, I asked God, I said, "What shall I speak about?" And I mean, without hesitation, it came to me the question, "Who am I?" And that's something that we have to ask all of us. Who am I? We can be a lot of things, but we have to define who am I. Also, you know, I like to play with acronyms. So my acronym for history, H-I-S-T-O-R-O-Y, honoring, individual, spiritual testimony on resurrecting you. That goes straight to Christ. The spiritual testimony that he gave was the sacrifice of his life. And that was about resurrecting us to where we needed to be. When we look at the great migration from the continent of Africa, they talk about the Holocaust. We had millions upon millions upon millions lost that made a sacrifice for the building of this nation. And so when I ask myself, who am I? I am one that's standing on the shoulders of those that came before me. I'm standing on the shoulders of W.E.B. Du Bois. I'm standing on the shoulders of a Nat Turner. And Nat Turner is one that, you know, we should pay close attention to. Nat Turner was an activist, but he was also a minister. And he led a slave revolt to free the slaves. But he was a magnificent, magnificent man, and one that we should recognize, one that we should tell our children about. I don't want to get ahead of myself, but this is a picture of Nat Turner. Here. I know all of you may not be able to see it, but I will have a display in the room when we get ready to have our feast that you can be able to look at pictures and get information. But one of the things that I really wanted to emphasize today is that our history is rich. They only give us 1 month, but we got 365 days of Black history. You know, there's something significant that happens every day on this continent about what we did to make this place what it is today. And we should be proud of that. And proud is a strong word, but we made that sacrifice. There are a lot of books that are out there that you won't find in schools. And one in particular that I like to make reference to is called Black Presence in the Bible. And as I was sharing with the pastor, we're studying in the books of Acts right now. And here's what it says about Black presence in the Bible. Acts 17:26, and hath made of one blood all nations of men for to dwell on all the face of the earth, and has determined that times before appointed and the bounds of their habitation. And what it says here is that the Bible is the infallible, authoritative word of God. It is the only place we can go to receive a totally accurate and objective understanding of a race. It also says, when a person understands the glorious presence of African people in God's drama on the unfolding of human history in general and redemptive history in particular, it becomes clear that the scripture should be the primary source of legitimate Black pride. It says also, since race has played such a vital role in social development and the functioning of American society, it behooves one to discover a divine response to this topic. It also says, a study of race rooted in the Bible links the pride and understanding of race with eternal purpose. So we can't study our history unless we study the Bible. And they are taking the Bible out of the school. And that's where books like The Miseducation of the Negro comes in, Carter G. Woodson. And then you won't see books like this, 100 Amazing Facts About the Negro by J.A. Rogers. There's also another book that you won't see, and I saw everyone clapping when they saw Barack. And I don't want to disappoint any of you, but Barack was not our first Black president. We had 5 Negro presidents before Barack. One of them was John Hanson. John Hanson was the one that appointed George Washington, General George Washington. So these are things that we need to pass on to our children, about where we come from. When you look at the charts behind me, there are two charts. One is entitled American History and African Perspective. And that's the perspective of what Africa had on America. The second chart is World History and African Perspective. And that's the perspective that Africa had on the world. I can name, and I have these books, an author by the name of Dr. Yosef Binyakinen. They call him Dr. Ben. He wrote a book called Africa, Mother of Western Civilization, meaning that we got our beginning on the continent. People here in America came from Africa. Everything that America is built on came from the continent. Ancient Egypt, Light of the World. Everybody know this lady, Nefertiti. Listen what it says about Nefertiti. She was probably influential in the establishment of the monotheistic worship of the sun god Aten. Nefertiti was one of only queens in prayer and therefore was accordingly divinity while her husband was still alive. So there was spirituality back with Nefertiti that, you know, we don't talk about. They talk about the beauty of Nefertiti, but let's talk about the history of Nefertiti, what her spirit was like. This is very, very important. I know it may seem like I'm jumping all over the place, but our history is just vast. So vast. And what I'm about to share with you now, I really want you to prepare yourself for, because we talk about Black Lives Matter. We talk about what happened in Ferguson, what, you know, the killing of black men. These are replicas of our struggle. These are the shackles that they bounded us with when we came over on slave ships. We talk about, I can't do this, I can't do that. But what about what these our forefathers had to go through to get here? There's one thing that I would like to ask all of us, even myself. We need to say to ourselves, I can, I will, I must. I can educate, I will educate, I must educate. I can teach, I will teach, I must teach. I can be a child of God, I will be a child of God, I must be a child of God. These are the things that we have to pass on to the little ones. If they can get up here like the young people got up here today and speak, then what are we going to do? We've got to create a path for them to follow. So when I look at the sacrifice that Christ made, be pierced in his side, to be hung on a cross, then to have my forefathers brought over on slave ships and shackles, and millions upon millions didn't even make it. There's a door on the continent of Cameroon, which is on the continent of Africa, and they have a door there, and it's called the door of no return. Because everyone that went through that door, they were going on to slave ships. And the things that they talk about as far as our slave, I mean, how we got here and what we had to go through when we got here. We're going through a lot of those same things now, but I'll say to you, just like C.C. Winans got a song called It Wasn't Easy, but it was worth it. So anything that we face, it may not be easy, but it's worth it. There's also another book, What They Never Told You in a History Class. And there's so many things that it's really earth-shattering why it's not in the school system. When you look at a dollar bill, one of the things that you see on the dollar bill is Egyptian pyramid. But there's also something else that's on that inside that pyramid, and that's the Eye of Horus. That's an Egyptian god. But I will say the leaders of this country, although I don't think they are leaders, they know who rules, and it's their silent way of paying homage to those Egyptians or to God. I always think about the old play where, you know, you'd see the puppet and the puppeteer. We always saw the puppets, but we never saw the puppeteer. And in America, as far as our history is concerned, we think that, hey, the president runs things. And to a certain degree, he does, but he is not the puppet. I mean, not the puppeteer. He's the puppet. And that's something we need to understand about our history. If we want to know who the puppeteer is, and there's only one true puppeteer, and that's God. Because he's calling the shot. He's making the way. So we've got 365 days of black history. And I mean, there are some powerful things happening. Right here in Wyandotte County, we have the first African-American Wyandotte County prosecutor, black prosecutor. Now, that's not by happenstance. That's God at work. And what we need to do is to be supportive of that black prosecutor, to let him know we support him, because he can only do his job when he has the support of the people. Just like pastor can't do his job unless he got the support of the congregation. These are all the things that we need to be teaching about our history. I talked about Nat Turner. One of the things that I learned about Nat Turner, and I saw the movie Birth of a Nation. Did anybody see that? One of the things that I learned about Nat Turner, when God equipped him with something, he used it for the people. We go and watch movies, Hidden Figures. When God equips you with something, gives you a talent, we have to use that talent. I'm going to make reference to something that my wife helped me with as far as this presentation. And I think it's necessary that we make this a part of our daily walk. In In Hosea, verse 4 through 6, it says, my people are destroyed from a lack of knowledge. Because you have rejected knowledge, I also reject you as my priest. Because you have ignored the law of your God, I will ignore your children. So if we don't try to increase our knowledge about who we are, then God's not going to answer our prayer. If we don't seek his face and learn about him, he's not going to respond. Exodus 3, verse 6. Verse 7. The Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I've heard them cry out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their suffering. The last one is Chronicles 7:14. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sins and will heal their land. What's going on in the country right now? Do our land needs healing? But are we seeking his face? That's history, seeking God's face. That's as basic and as essential as you can get. We come to church, and a lot of us come to church just out of habit, rather than having a desire to become closer to God. Knowing that if I become closer to him, my life is going to be at peace. I'm going to know not only who I am, but where I come from. And the only way I can get to where I'm going is to know that. Otherwise, I'm just running around like a clanging cymbal. There's one last song that I want to have Sister Donna play. Sister Robin play. And Marvin Gaye is going to sing the song. But more important, it's the words again that I would ask that you listen to. And you also look at some of the video that goes along with it. What did he say? This ain't living the way they do my life. And the only reason that they do that is because our thinking. I want to leave you with some books that hopefully you will try to obtain. But there are some very, very powerful, powerful books. One of the books is called They Came Before Columbus, Africa's Presence in Ancient America. The other one is From Babylon to Timbuktu, A History of Ancient Black Race in the Bible. the historical origin of Christianity. And I know the pastor get a kick out of this one. Enoch, the Ethiopian, the lost prophets of the Bible. There's another one called Wonderful Ethiopians of the Cushite Empire, the people of Cush. And the word Cush means black. Also, the rise and fall of Black Wall Street. Black Wall Street, can you imagine that? That in Oklahoma, we had a Black Wall Street where we owned banks, we had hospitals, we had schools, we were financially in Oklahoma, financially independent. And so, just those books alone, do you see them in the schools? One of the things that I'm going to share with you now, I don't know if many of you know it. Everybody knew Martin Luther King. Everybody know he won the Nobel Peace Prize. How many people know that in 1960s, Martin Luther King's annual income was over $200,000 a year? You know how much money he kept of that? He kept $6,000. And he got $4,000 from the church, Ebenezer Church. So he lived off, he supported his family on $10,000 a year in 1960. So that says something about sacrifice. And if we are not willing to sacrifice for our church, for our people, then we're not really living, as Marvin say. So with that, I would just like to thank you all, and I would hope that whatever little information I was able to share with you, that, you know, it will be useful. And I thank God for the opportunity, and I thank Pastor for the opportunity.